In this session of Numerical Methods, I'd like to continue discussing the Monte Carlo method. So we already started discussing the Monte Carlo method. We saw that if we have a sequence of IID random variables, then if we take the running average, it converges to the expectation. Expectation of all these guys is the same, IID. And we also had, using the Chebyshev inequality, a kind of convergence rate. A little bit disappointing that it holds only in probability. But apart from that, a nice result. And today I like to apply this and introduce Monte Carlo integration. So you can just reinterpret what was on the slide as a nice method to calculate integrals. So before I start with that, let me shortly summarize three aspects from our last session from the Monte Carlo methods. So the first aspect was that we will later consider, drawings of a given random variable, And I just wanted to remind you that what is the formal understanding of this. So if you have, so let's take small letter x. So if you have a sequence here, x1, x2, and so on, which I will later then say is a random number sequence. So say, for example, from R, this sequence is a drawing of a random variable x. So to model this, actually it is that this sequence, so x1 to xn, is the evaluation of a single random variable, say x tilde, on a single event. Yeah? So a sequence of events corresponds to actually a single events. So this is how we model the independence, where the x tilde, so that is the capital X, is now a sequence of IID random variables. So this is the underlying framework that gives me the independence, in this drawing. So with Xi being IID random variables. So IID random variables having the same distribution as X. So why do I like to remind you of that? It's because this aspect here that we are considering such a drawing, we are actually looking at a single event, and we have convergence results in probability. So that is the second aspect I want to remind you. So in the last session, we were looking at sequences of IID random variables, so with the same distribution of X, and then assuming that, under certain condition, assuming that the expectation exists, we have that this running average, so the average of these guys, converges to the expectation of X as n goes to infinity, and that is P almost surely. So in probability. So we have some convergence in probability to the expectation, but note the issue that here when we are looking at drawings, I'm just looking at the single event. So there is a little bit of a gap. And I also had it on the slide. Yeah, we not only have this, we even have an estimate for the convergence rate. So the probability that a random variable Z deviates from the expectation of that by more than epsilon. Okay, so the probability that I'm outside a given range related to the convergence is less than the variance of that divided by epsilon squared. So that was our Chebyshev inequality. And then we just used that, plugging in here our Monte Carlo average. So the sum xi, I from 1 to n divided by n. Okay, and then we got this nice result that this average here of the IID random variables deviates from the expectation by, and now there were different versions how we could write the inequality. Yeah, we can go to the opposite event. Yeah, so we can go to less than. Yeah, so then it is here on the other side, one minus something, and then we can substitute the epsilon with a special choice. Say that we have a given delta here. Okay, and then we saw that here we have the sigma. Yeah, so it is taking here. Here is epsilon squared, here is epsilon, yeah, so there will be some square root here, so sigma, it is not the variance, it's the square root of the variance divided by square root delta times n, yeah, so you see if you have, if you would like to have a larger probability that this holds, you have to use a smaller delta, then the range gets larger. Or if you like to have here a smaller range, then it doesn't hold with the same probability, or you have to use a larger number of samples. Okay, so that was just a small recap of our last session. Yeah, so these three aspects. So the two below is that we have some method, yeah, to approximate the expectation operator. And the first issue is that if we just look at this on a single sequence of drawings, then we are actually looking just at a single event. So the following little lemma now allows us to extend the application of this. Okay, so what's the point? So we are looking here at some function f. So here from R to R, but actually later we will see that we can use it also on RD, yeah, in D dimensions. And if you have that xi is a sequence of iid random variables, then z being f of xi is also iid. Okay, so why is that? Yeah, so that's okay, that's just because we have again a new random variable and all the independence properties, yeah, are still holding. And why is that now useful for us? So why is this little lemma useful for us? Because I can now just plug in the random variable sequence zi into our previous theorems. So that means if we plug in zi, I have that 1 divided by n, taking the sum I from 1 to n, zi, so that is f of xi. This converges to the expectation of f of x, yeah, so okay, I don't have an x here, so the, but they are all iid, so just take x1. And now assume that we are in a special case. Assume that the xi's are uniform distributed on, say, 0, 1. And if you like, you can also take here on 0, 1, d. Yeah? So then you would have to take here also the d. Huh? So a small remark here. This holds also in d dimensions. Okay, so if you have that the xi is uniform distributed on 0, 1, then you know the density. Now the density is just 1 on this interval. And then I know that this here, so under this additional assumption, is just the integral. So take the average over all possible values. This is just the integral over 0, 1, no? If you like in d dimensions, if you like to just look at this first in one dimension, yeah, then just the integral from 0 to 1. So all possible values of x, f of x times the density, but the density of a uniform is just identity 1 dx. Okay, so that means I have here a method to approximate an integral. So I have a numerical method to calculate an approximation for an integral. I have an integration method. So we have an integration method. Okay, and a nice aspect is what we will to look later is that this scales very nicely in the dimension, but that will come later. Here you find this, what I just wrote, a little bit cleaner in LaTeX. So we now have a nice interpretation, a nice integration method. So this gives an integration method or integration approximation method, so to be precise. And we can apply our convergence rate result. So convergence, if I now define here, say, the integral, so how would I define the integral? So what is the integration approximation method? So I have that the integral over this interval, f of x dx is now approximated with 1 divided by n. Take the sum over these iid random variables. Yeah, so the set I, but this is f of xi. Okay, and that is equal to taking this sequence. Yeah, if I now evaluate this on the single event. Okay, so now comes the drawing. This here is 2 approximation steps, yeah, right? The first one is that I have convergence to the left-hand side. And the second one is that now I evaluate this at a single event omega. Okay, so actually there are 2 approximation steps hidden here. And then I have that this here is just 1 divided by n, take the sum from 1 to n, f of little xi. So for a sequence of numbers, being just evaluate xi at omega, so drawings of xi. Okay, and this guy here is now my approximation of the integral. So I define this as I of this f. Of course, it depends on the number n I use. Yeah, so I expect that the approximation gets better if I use a large number of n. But also it depends on the sequence I use. Yeah, so it depends on the omega. So convergence holds, but only in probability. So you see here on the right hand side, this guy here is a random variable. Yeah? So the map omega to the approximation of the integral is a random variable. And our convergence result is now that the distance of this random variable, so the difference between IFN and the true integral, 0, 1, f of x dx, this can be estimated. So the probability that this is smaller than sigma divided by square root of delta times 1 divided by square root of n. So if n becomes larger, yeah, we get convergence, it gets smaller. So this probability is larger than 1 minus delta. So the sad thing here is that this here holds only in probability. Okay, yeah, so we have an approximation method. If we plug in an omega in a random variable, we think that this could approximate here the integral on the left-hand side, and our convergence result holds only in probability. So the integral here is of course the expectation of f of x, so that is our mu. Yeah? So expectation of f of x, say 1. So a little remark, what is this sigma that appears here? Okay, so sigma squared is the variance. Sigma squared is the variance of our random variable, but our random variable is the f of x. Yeah. So this here is the variance of f of x. Okay, all xi have the same variance, so I can use x1. Okay, so there is somewhere in this estimate is hidden if the function has a larger or smaller variance. Of course, if you like to integrate a constant function, yeah, one point is enough. It's just the value times the length of the integral interval. The length of the interval is here 1. Yeah? So just one value would be enough. Okay, so now we have a nice method. Before, I like to say define and then explore the Monte Carlo integration method, I would like to look at a classical integration method. So an integration method like a Riemann sum or a trapezoidal rule. Yeah? And here I have a Simpson's rule, which is a little bit more complicated, has a little bit better convergence, yeah, than the other two. And we will need a few minutes to introduce this and discuss this, but I hope that this helps later to understand why the Monte Carlo method is actually different and why the fact that we have here something that holds only in probability enables a certain feature. So it's good to look at this again. And also I believe that getting the right intuition, why things are working, you know, why a numerical method is working and how it works, is maybe the most important thing of such a lecture. Yeah? I mean, theorems and proofs, you can look them up, but having a good intuition, yeah, is sometimes hard to look it up. Okay, so let's have a look at a classical integration rule here, Simpson's rule. So if you like to have an approximation for such an integral, here the Simpson's rule. So Simpson's rule allows me to approximate an integral. Here on the slide, a one-dimensional integral from A to B. Yeah. So instead from 0 to 1, now I have from A to B, but that's just a translation. Yeah, that's an easy part. Okay, and you can approximate this integral using 3 points if you place the points in a special way and use some special coefficients. Okay, and that's here the rule. So my approximation is f of a plus 4 times f of a plus b half, so f at the middle point, plus f of b. So you see these are, to some extent, 6 times the function. Yeah. Okay. One function here, one function here, 4 times the function here. So I divide by 6, yeah, and then it's like an average, and then multiplied with the length of the interval. Okay. So, and these strange coefficients 1, 4, 1 somehow enable that the Simpson's rule has a nice error bound, yeah, so we get something here that the error is bounded by the length of the interval half to the power of 5. Okay, so that is, of course, you can you prove this by approximating with a polynomial, and then this special choice of coefficients here leads to some canceling, so you get sometimes a better order in the convergence. So I don't like to prove this and just discuss some property. First thing is this is just using 3 points. So say, for example, your interval A and B is here. Yeah. So I'm using here the 3 points. So what is if you like to integrate, say, here over a larger interval? Of course, if you have this situation, you can just discretize this interval into many points. So now I'm deriving the composite Simpson's rule. So we try to use many points, and we use the Simpson's rule that we have for. So and we use the Simpson's rule that we have here for such an interval with 3 points again. For the next points. So such an interval here from A to B always comprises 2 intervals in my discretization from x0 to here x10. Yeah? So in this example. So if you combine now the 2 integrals, so I integrate now from here to here, yeah? I combine the 2 integrals. So I take the sum. Yeah? So I have one function evaluation in x0, 4 function evaluations here in x1, or 4 times f of x1. And then I have here 1 plus 1, which is the endpoint of the previous integration rule, and the starting point plus the starting point of the next integration rule. So, and the intervals here, which was my interval from A to B, is of course now 2 times h, if h is the size of my time discretization. Yeah, so the time discretization step, yeah, or here the x discretization. Yeah? So if x is time, it's time. Yeah, then you just continue, and we get that we have a coefficient of 1 on the outer points, and we have a coefficient of 2 whenever 2 such integrations will come together. And of course, the coefficient of 4 here from the middle point of the Simpson's integration rule. Okay, so that should work, yeah, if we have an even number of intervals. Yeah. So an even number of intervals means that I have an odd number of points, yeah, because the beginning point and the end point, you have one additional point, yeah. So either an interval corresponds to the beginning point, then the end point is an additional point. So I need an odd number of points, and now I have a nice rule. If I use this sequence of coefficients on function evaluations at x0, x1, x2, then I get the so-called composite Simpson's rule. So then I get an integration rule that uses more points. What about the error bound? Yeah, so my error bound here, had here the coefficient b minus a half. Yeah? So remember that this here was a and this here was b for a single integration rule. Yeah? So b minus a half actually corresponds to h. Okay, so you have h to the power of 5. You have h to the power of 5 in each of these integrations here, in that one, and in that one, and in that one. So if I sum up, yeah, so I of course integrate one h, so I have an h to the power of 4 left. Yeah? So because if I sum up here, h, yeah, I get then the length of the interval. Okay, so that's here my composite Simpson's rule. Yeah, so just because that's maybe not just still in your mind. Yeah, so I get here is the error bound an h to the power of 4, which is the h to the power of 5 from the previous slide, multiplied with b minus a, yeah, which is one of the h to the power of 5 summed up. Huh? So that is now the whole interval. Yeah, so that is here my xm, the last point, minus x0. So maybe a small remark. So note a and b. Here the starting and end point of the whole interval. So that guy here is called now A, and that guy here is now called B. Okay, so I integrate now from A to B, yeah, over that whole interval using m plus one. Now I have an additional parameter here in my integration rule. I have the parameter, how many points do I use? So now the integration becomes this expression, which is just evaluate the function at these discretization points. So we have the endpoints x0 and xm, which enter with a coefficient of 1. And then we have the odd points, x2j minus 1, so the odd points, which enter with a coefficient of 4. And we have the even points in our discretization, x2j, which enter with a coefficient 2. And that's a fairly good integration rule, and it's not so complicated. Yeah? You have to remember the discretization. Yeah? You have an equidistant discretization and the coefficients, and then you have a nice integration rule. It's a little bit similar to our Monte Carlo approximation. Yeah? So you evaluate the function at some points. Yeah, but with the Monte Carlo integral, which I just motivated, we have random points. And here you have some specific points. Okay, so here is a small implementation of this We will have a look at this in the next session. So we have a code session where we implement this. But first I like to do the Monte Carlo method and compare then the two implementations. You can generalize this integration rule to higher dimensions. And let's look what happens to the integration rule if you generalize it to higher dimension. So first thing is that we still have the error bound, that the error is order of h to the power of 4. So if you go back, we had here the error bound. The error is order h to the power of 4. Yeah? So h to the power of 5, but 1 h is consumed by that we sum up over all these small intervals. And if you sum up over all the intervals of size h, you get here the length of the whole interval, b minus a, as a constant. So I have an h to the power of 4 as the convergence rate. You can generalize this, of course, easily to higher dimensions. So if you are, for example, in two dimensions, and you like to integrate from, say, a1 to b1 in the first coordinate, and from a2 to b2 in the second coordinate, then you can do an integral for a fixed y. So say this here is y, this here is x. So then you calculate an integral along that line here using the discretization points. And so since this is a Simpson's rule, this here is an endpoint, and then we have the odd ones in blue and the even ones in green. No, the even ones in blue and the odd ones in green. Yeah, so then we have a Simpson's rule. Then you do all these Simpson's rule, say along certain lines. Okay, so you need another integration here, another integration here, another one here, and another one here. And then you have a rectangle now of 5 by 5 points. Okay, and then you also get for each little integration this integration bound, yeah, over the whole area. Yeah, we sum up all the small rectangles. So you see, in order to get the same h to the power of 4 bound, I need m plus 1 to the power of d points. Yeah? So here is the example. D equals 2, dimension equals 2. Here is m equals 4. So the number of evaluation points equals 5. I have 4 intervals and 5 points in each dimension. So if I would like to write this formula using the same number of points, okay, then this means I define here n is m plus 1 to the power of d. So given that I have n points, of course, for this classical integration rule, say in two dimension, n has to be a squared. Yeah, so maybe something like 16, 25, and so on. But given that I have n points, how does the convergence in terms of the number of points look like? Okay, so if n is equal to m plus 1 to the power of d, and my h is the length of the interval divided by m, then I see order h to the power of 4 is the same as n to the power of minus 1 divided by d. Yeah? The d's root of 1 divided by n to the power of 4. So we get that this is order of n to the power of minus 4 divided by d. So this here is 1 divided by n to the power of 4 divided by d. Okay, so if you increase the number of points that you use, you get a better convergence. It's 1 divided by n, so it's getting smaller. And the exponent is 4 divided by d. Okay, so that's now the convergence in higher dimensions. Okay, and maybe a small little teaser. I will discuss this later again. Let's go back to the Monte Carlo method. There we also had a dependency on the number of points. It was 1 divided by n to the power of 1/2. So you see, if the dimension is 8 or larger, you have the same or worse convergence rate. Okay, so now let's define the Monte Carlo integral. Yeah, I already wrote it down in the motivation. So we have this little lemma. We consider a function in d dimensions. Yeah, so now the dimension matters here, yeah, because that is later really a nice feature. The function maps from the unit cube in d dimension to R. So the sequence of random variables has to be a vector valued sequence. So a d dimensional vector valued sequence of IID random variables having uniform distribution on my integration domain. Okay, and then we call here this guy the Monte Carlo integral. Yeah, so our average of f of xi. Okay, so we know that this guy converges to the expectation, so that guy converges to the integral over our domain. Yeah, so now that is in here the dimension f of x dx. This is now our definition of the Monte Carlo approximation of this integral. Yeah, so this here is the Monte Carlo approximation of this integral, our Monte Carlo integral, with n sample points. So we use n evaluations of the functions. Well, sample points, in this notation, it is random variables, but we will evaluate this at a fixed omega, then it is a sequence of sample points. Here I have a code that performs integration using this method. I will discuss this code in the next session when we compare the two methods. And but just see from the slide, yeah, that the code is much shorter. Yeah, the method is much simpler. So the Chebyshev inequality gives us the error estimate. I already derived that. So now we have the convergence rate in a probabilistic sense, or let's say a probabilistic error bound for our Monte Carlo integral. So the probability that our Monte Carlo integral deviates here by more than some given sigma divided by square root of delta square root of n from the true integral is less than delta. And now comes the really important remark. The dimension d does not enter in this error bound. So does not enter in the convergence rate. No? D does not appear here and D does not appear there. Okay, and you can go back to Chebyshev inequality, where we derived that. We cut it out a certain region of a certain volume. Yeah? We cut it out a certain region of a certain volume from the integral, and that was independent from the dimension. So here we have convergence, which is of the order 1 divided by square root of n. Well, this O notation, yeah, it's maybe not correct because it is only in probability. And also note again here that the constant sigma that is here is the variance, square root of the variance of the function of x. So that the function of x, if the function has a large variation, yeah, that will change, of course, here the bound. So compare this result here to a classical integration rule, like Simpson's rule. Okay, so here you have order 1 divided by square root of n, so n to the power of minus 1/2. And here we had 1 divided by n to the power of 4 divided by d. If the dimension gets larger, this method in terms of convergence by number of points gets slower. The other not. Okay, so that's the Monte Carlo integral. You can rewrite this error estimate also here using L2 norm. And I have a nice computer experiment that illustrates that this method is really nice and easy. So for example, if you like to calculate the area of the unit circle on the unit cube, so I have here integral from minus 1 to 1 in two dimensions. I'm integrating here the indicator function. Indicator function here over the unit cube. So that means I'm calculating here the area of this circle. I calculate the area of this circle. So since the radius is 1, so that here is 1, the area of the circle is just p. So I calculate p. So how do I calculate p? So I integrate here this integral over this domain. So I formulated everything in the domain from 0 to 1, but that's not an issue. So I just transform the domain. So I just get 4 times the domain from 0 to 1, because we have 4 sectors. Or you could also say that this is the rule of substitution, and du by dx is 2. And dv by dy is also 2, so you get 2 times 2 is 4. Okay, and then you can just calculate this with the Monte Carlo method by drawing random points. Okay, and whenever the point is inside, you evaluate the function. So the function is the indicator function is 1. And whenever the point is outside, you don't count the point. It is 0. So it's just draw random points and count how many points are inside. And that's p. Okay, so maybe we can do this experiment in one of our next sessions and stop here, because that was already a nice introduction of the Monte Carlo integral. And in the next session, I like to implement the two methods and compare them a little bit using the streams API.